All right, here we go. Hey, everyone. Today, we're going to dive into what is honestly the absolute peak of internal combustion piston engine technology, the modern Formula One power unit. And yeah, I'm calling it a power unit instead of just an engine because, well, it's not just one thing. It's this incredibly complex combination of components that all work together to create something unlike anything else on the planet. So let's start with the heart of it all, the internal combustion engine itself. Right now, in 2025, Formula One rules have them running a 1.6 liter 90 degree V6 configuration. That's six cylinders arranged in a tight V shape, and it's boosted by a single turbocharger. Just one turbo. On paper, you might think, okay, well, that doesn't sound too different from some high performance road cars. And in a very basic sense, you'd be right. Air comes in through an air filter, passes through the compressor side of the turbo, then goes through an intercooler to drop the temperature before heading into the cylinders. But there's a twist. Instead of just piping air straight into the intake, these engines use what's called a plenum chamber, basically a sealed air box that collects and distributes air evenly to each cylinder. It's almost always made from lightweight composites like carbon fiber to keep weight down. The goal is to make sure every single cylinder is getting the exact same amount of air at the exact same pressure, so combustion is perfectly balanced across all six. Now, the shape, size, and flow characteristics of those cylinders aren't just dreamed up by the engineers over coffee. They're designed down to the microscopic detail based on the molecular structure of the fuel each team uses. So, for example, Mercedes works closely with Petronas, who will tell them the exact molecular breakdown of their fuel, and then the engine geometry is designed to make the absolute most of it. This means the air-fuel mixture inside the combustion chamber is distributed with perfect uniformity, and when ignition happens, the burn is even throughout. Because the compression ratios are sky high, they need special spark plugs that can handle insane pressures. We're talking about each piston experiencing forces equivalent to four elephants sitting on it during combustion. And the temperatures? At peak, the inside of the cylinder is hitting around 2,750 degrees Celsius. That's about half the surface temperature of the sun. Obviously, nothing in your average road car is coming anywhere close to this.
Once the fuel burns and expands, the exhaust gases spin the turbine side of the turbo before shooting out the exhaust. Thanks to this level of engineering, modern F1 power units can reach thermal efficiencies of around 50%. That means half of the chemical energy in the fuel is converted directly into usable mechanical power. Compare that to a regular road car, which is usually somewhere in the low 30% range, and you can see just how far ahead these things are. But of course, this level of efficiency doesn't happen by accident. It's a blend of special fuels, cutting-edge design, and millions of dollars of development. But the internal combustion engine is only one part of the story. The other major piece is the hybrid system, called the ERS, Energy Recovery System. And yes, technically that makes these cars hybrids, but they're way more advanced than the hybrids you see in normal passenger cars. The ERS actually has two separate motor generator units and a battery pack, plus a control unit that manages all of it. One of these motors is called the MGU-H, the heat motor, and the other is the MGU-K, the kinetic motor. The MGU-H is connected to the turbocharger, while the MGU-K is connected directly to the crankshaft. Here's where it gets fun. Imagine you're flat out down a long straight. The turbo is spinning like crazy thanks to the exhaust gases, and the compressor is pushing tons of air into the engine. At that point, the MGU-H can actually switch into generator mode, taking excess energy from the spinning turbo and converting it into electricity. That electricity can either be stored in the battery for later or sent straight to the MGU-K to add extra power to the crankshaft. That's worth around 160 horsepower, although the exact numbers are a closely guarded secret by the teams. Now, when the driver lifts off the throttle and starts braking, the MGU-K can harvest kinetic energy from the wheels and feed it back into the battery. Meanwhile, the MGU-H can use some of that stored energy to keep the turbo spinning even when there's no exhaust flow, eliminating turbo lag completely. That means when the driver gets back on the throttle, full boost is available instantly. Oh, and by the way, that turbo is spinning at over 100,000 RPM, and the control systems work constantly to make sure it never drops too low.
A little more on the mechanical side. The combustion engine uses four valves per cylinder, two intake and two exhaust, and per F1 regulations, the engine block has to be made from an aluminum alloy, not composites. There's also a strict fuel limit. Teams can only use up to 105 kilograms of fuel in a race, and the fuel flow rate into the engine is capped at 27 grams per second. Even the rev limit is regulated, 15,000 RPM max, though the engines could spin faster if the rules allowed it. These restrictions are partly about keeping competition close and partly about safety.
The minimum weight for the engine itself is 145 kilograms, and the battery packs have to be between 20 and 25 kilograms. And here's an interesting one. Even though hybrids can give huge off-the-line acceleration, F1 cars aren't allowed to use the hybrid boost below 100 kilometers per hour. The idea is to keep starts dependent on the driver's skill, not just the technology. What's maybe the most impressive takeaway here is that 50% efficiency figure. If we could get that level of efficiency into regular cars, we'd massively cut fuel consumption and emissions while getting way more power. The problem, of course, is cost. Developing an F1 power unit costs millions upon millions of dollars, and if you tried to put that same tech into a family sedan, the price tag would be, let's just say nobody's buying it. Plus, road car fuel quality can vary so much that you can't always run these extreme compression ratios safely. So for now, road cars stick to their more modest efficiency numbers. Add it all up, the internal combustion engine, the hybrid system, the electronics, and you're looking at a total output that's right around 1,000 horsepower in today's top F1 cars. Back in 2017, Ferrari was rumored to have gotten extremely close to that number, and today in 2025, we're right at that mark. This is the absolute cutting edge of piston engine technology, and honestly, it's hard to imagine internal combustion getting any more advanced than this before the sport fully shifts to alternative powertrains. But for now, this is where we are. If you love this kind of deep dive into motorsport engineering, drop a comment. Let me know what other racing tech you'd like me to cover. And yeah, hit that like button if you enjoyed it.